I Good morning. Good morning and welcome to Towson Presbyterian Church, where together we are always striving to be an inclusive, curious, a compassionate, and a courageous congregation. My name is Joel. I'm one of the pastors here at TPC. Pastor Rob is away today, but we'll be back next week. Today is the second Sunday in the season of Easter. It's also the first Sunday of the month, so it is a Communion Sunday. And for those that are with us virtually, we invite you to join us in this meal by gathering bread, cracker, juice, or water, and joining us when we gather around this table later in the service. For those that are virtual, you can also follow along with our bulletin. It can be found at towsonpress.org/bulletin. For those with us in person, we invite you to let us know you were with us today by filling out the maroon pads at the end of the pew. Fill those out, pass them down, note who was with you, say hello to them during the passing of the peace, and then back to the end of the pew. A couple announcements to share this morning. First, we have a birth announcement to celebrate. We celebrate the new life of Henry Thomas Barton, grandson of Rick and Jane Barton. Give thanks for Henry Thomas. Our Honduras team arrived on Thursday in Copan Ruinas in Honduras and are hard at work and the good work they're doing. So our prayers with them over the next week. After worship today in the library, we'll be watching a video called On Being Muslim. It's a video resource from ICJS, the Institute for Islamic, Christian, and Jewish Studies. All are invited to that. That's in our library after worship. Project Clean Stream is later today from 4 to 6 p.m. We'll meet by the bridge on Lanjirondel Club Road. I never pronounced that word correctly. Don't forget to check out our Earth Month calendar. It can be found at towsonpress.org/earthcare with its daily activities as we slowly make our way to Earth Day, Earth Sunday, here at TPC on April 21st. And now, friends, let us turn our hearts and our minds to the worship of God. If you're able, please stand for our call to worship. Today, we continue the journey. Today, we re-enter the story. Today, we re-enter the story. Within sights and sounds,
within words and symbols,
together let us worship God. For Christ is risen, he is risen indeed.
Thank you.
The journey of faith, the journey of discipleship, of following Jesus and living a particular way in the world is a difficult one and not meant to be easy. And so we offer our confession together so we can begin again. Let us pray. We are so easily confused by what the world tells us, loving God, that we forget the stories of faith we heard as children. We are so fearful of tomorrow, we are not aware of your Spirit with us today. We are so busy wondering what if or suppose that we cannot hear the promises you whisper to us. So once again, gracious God, have mercy on us. You know our hearts so well. Touch them with your grace. You see our deepest fears. Heal them with your peace. You hear our secret longings. Speak to them of your hope. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. This is the good news we have declared. God leads us out of the shadows to walk in the light of Christ. This is the word we have heard. Our faithful God forgives, accepts, and raises us to new life. Thanks be to God. Amen. On the evening of Jesus' resurrection, the disciples were gathered in fear and sadness, wondering how everything had gone so wrong. Friends, may the peace of the risen Christ be with you. And to those with us virtually, we invite you to share the peace with your gathered community. And to our children, we invite you to come on down and join me for the children's message. Well, good morning. It's good to have you. Come on down and join us. Thank you for coming up. It's a little lonely up here without, I don't have Pastor Rob or Miss Jeanette here with me, but I'm glad that you are here with me today. So as I said, today is the first Sunday of the month, and it's a communion Sunday, so our communion table is set and ready for us to share a meal together. And so if you are in second grade and below, you get to go to children's chapel today. But if you're third grade and up, we invite you to stay in the service with us and experience this meal that we're going to share. And from a quick glance, we've got some bread and we've got some juice. And it doesn't look incredibly special at first, but it's actually more than just bread and juice. It's actually a pretty special meal that we share together. And so what happens in this meal? Well, how it begins is I, or Pastor Rob, we will offer what we call the invitation to the table, where we let everyone know that they are invited to come forward. No matter how great your faith is that day, or maybe it doesn't feel as strong as it usually does, you're invited. No matter what you feel about yourself that day, you are invited to come to this table. Jesus invites you to this table. And then we say a prayer. We call it the Great Prayer of Thanksgiving, where we thank God for Jesus' life and for all he taught us. We thank God for God's Spirit in this meal, a part of this meal, and a part of our lives. And then we remember the story of Jesus sharing a final meal with his disciples. We retell that story, and then we get to relive that story. So we get to have bread and juice together, and we get to sit around the table and remember the story of Jesus sharing this meal with his disciples. And so really what this meal is about, in many ways, it's about remembering. It's about remembering God's love for us. It's about remembering what God invites us to do, which is go out and love. It's about remembering that when we share this meal together, that Jesus is with us. And so today, the first Sunday of the month, is a special day because we get to share together in this meal. So let's say a prayer together. If you could bow your heads and close your eyes, and you can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for this meal where we get to remember who we are and who you invite us to be and to do. Amen. Okay. So if you are third grade and up, you can stay here. And I think Miss Kirsten has children's chapel, and you can make your way to children's chapel. Please join me in a prayer. Dear God, as we open the scriptures and hear again the stories of our faith, open us once again to the presence of your Spirit and to the power of Easter. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the Gospel of Luke, Chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. This is Luke's version of the resurrection, but we pick up later in the day on Easter Sunday. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other and while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' And then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself and all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and he gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God. Well, today is the second Sunday in the season of Easter in the church calendar. And this season, which leads up to Pentecost Sunday, lasts 7 weeks. And the season of Easter, I've always found to be a bit anticlimactic and somewhat difficult to settle into. Lent has a rhythm to it and a destination to it. It's moving towards Holy Week and then finally Easter. Advent has a destination to it. It's moving with anticipation towards Christmas Eve. And we could say Pentecost Sunday is the destination for the season of Easter, but it's just not the same as the other two. The challenge of the season of Easter, maybe, is that the season begins with Easter Sunday. And Easter Sunday, as it should, comes flying out of the gate. Easter Sunday is this cacophony of noise and celebration and excitement and joy, and it's filled with friends and family. It's a great day that deserves all the fanfare that we give it. But after Easter Sunday gets shot out of a cannon, we're often left with the question of what do we do with the rest of this season? Because it's kind of downhill from here. It's quite fair to ask ourselves, then, how do we live into the season of Easter in light of the magnitude of Easter and the miraculous nature of that one day. Part of the challenge could reside in the expectation, in our expectation of Easter Sunday. Because it's Easter, we can often expect the miraculous and the supernatural. To be in relationship with God in light of Easter could be to expect, well, stones to be moved and the earth to tremble and to be greeted by angels. That's Easter, right? You might remember from the book of Acts in the New Testament, the story of Saul who became Paul. In Saul's story, he's on his way to Damascus to round up and arrest what he believes to be heretical Christians. And on his journey, he was suddenly engulfed in this great light that knocked him to the ground. Saul then hears the voice of Jesus who said to him, "Saul, why are you persecuting me? Get up and go to the city and I'll tell you what to do next." Now that's a story that has an Easter feel to it, right? It's a story that has an earth-shaking, transformative moment within it where Saul's life was forever changed. Saul began that day seeing the world one way, and by the end of the day, he saw the world in a completely different way. Sure sounds like Easter Sunday to me. But our gospel lesson, the story I just read, describes resurrection in a different kind of way. It's not Easter morning, but it's later in the day, and the disciples, two disciples, are on their way back from Jerusalem to Emmaus. They've heard rumors of the resurrection, but they can't confirm it. But what they do know is that Jesus died, and with it went their hopes of who he might be. And in this story, there isn't a cacophony of noise and excitement and celebration, but instead a story that seems a bit maybe quieter than we might expect. Maybe even a little subtle or restrained. It's a story that has the miraculous within it. Jesus is there, and then the next second he's not. But it also has some normalcy to it. Walking, talking, listening, wondering, and finally, eating. It almost feels a bit ordinary. The stories in the gospel that describe interactions with the risen Jesus are powerful, and we could say miraculous, but there's also a certain normality to them. The risen Jesus appears in everyday, typical ways. He appears to Mary, but she thinks he's the gardener tending to the landscaping. Jesus is on the beach cooking fish over a fire and invites Peter to sit and share a meal with him. And two people on the road to Emmaus, and Jesus comes and walks beside them. And as he walks beside them, Luke says that their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And it's one of the more interesting parts of the story. Now, I've always read it with the assumption that Jesus kept them from recognizing him. It was a divine action onto them. But biblical scholar Greg Carey sees it in a different way and says that he finds it more compelling to believe that the disciples' expectation of resurrection prevented them from recognizing Jesus. Their eyes were kept from recognizing Jesus because they didn't expect to see him in such a way. This was not the time and place where they would expect an encounter with Jesus. And if they did, wouldn't he be bathed in white with choirs of angels shouting praise? That's resurrection, right? Instead, he's just a guy walking next to them on the road. And the ordinariness of this story grows the more it unfolds. The two travelers reach their destination and convince Jesus to share a meal with them. And it's in the sharing of the meal, as Jesus took bread and he blessed it, and broke it, and he gave it to each of them, that their eyes were open and they recognized him. And they realized he'd been with them the whole time. This resurrection story is a story about the promise of God's presence, the presence of the risen Jesus around a shared meal. And that's what Jesus' followers have been doing since the very beginning and what we'll do today. Whether in the sanctuary or whether at home, we'll gather around this table here and we'll break bread and we'll pour the cup and we'll eat and we'll drink and we'll remember. And there's nothing incredibly magical about this meal. In many ways, it feels very ordinary. Our tradition doesn't believe that we're consuming the actual body and blood of Jesus. It's just bread, juice, wine, or a cracker. But what we do believe and what we do trust is that Jesus meets us in this meal. Jesus' presence is with us when we eat and when we drink together. And this meal has a way of helping us to remember. We remember who we are and who God calls us to be, and we remember that just as the risen Jesus walked with the two travelers on their way to Emmaus, the risen Jesus walks with us today. And if we can remember God's presence with us when we share this meal, we can remember that same presence later this afternoon and tonight and tomorrow and the next day. We can trust in a God who promises to be with us through all of life, through all of what the two travelers experienced on their way to Emmaus. Discouragement, sadness, doubt, faith, wonder, wrestling with the scriptures, the joy of the good news of Easter and the presence of God in this meal. If we can trust it here, church, together, we can trust it out there, within our homes and our work, among family, among friends, within all that life will inevitably bring to our door. And so as we settle into the season of Easter with the intent to live into the reality of the resurrection, maybe we lean into it in a very normal and ordinary way. Just as we remember God's presence with us in this meal we are about to share today, what if we were to trust in God's presence whenever we sat down over the next few weeks and shared a meal, whether at home with family or by yourself? What if we very briefly and very simply offered gratitude for the food we are about to eat and gratitude for God's presence with us in that moment? And we could take it a little further, too. Maybe we're at a gathering with friends or family who are not the praying type, but that doesn't mean we can't remember. And so you still silently, to yourself, give thanks for God's presence in that very moment with you at that table right then and there. And maybe we take it a little further than that, too, and you briefly and simply offer gratitude for God's presence in each of the lives of everyone sitting with you, whether they trust in it or not. Gratitude for God's abiding presence, not just in your life, but in their life too. Because if we were to take something like that on, a very simple but I think powerful practice, what we might discover is that in the act of remembering God's presence in our lives and in the lives of those around us, we might discover that our hearts are more alive. We might discover that our hearts are more open and receptive to the presence of God in our lives. We might discover our hearts are more open and live, are more alive and open to the lives of those who, with whom we share a meal. We might discover a deeper sense of the presence of the risen one in the world around us. We might discover, as the two travelers on the road to Emmaus did, that our hearts are burning, more aware of the one who walks beside us each and every day. The season of Easter is a little subtle. It's maybe a little restrained, maybe even a little quiet at times, but still powerful. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Thanks be to God. May be seated. So today we look back on Holy Week, where we once again told the story of Jesus' passion. And not only was it a great week together, but it wouldn't have happened without each of you. So here's a recap of who joined us this past week. On Maundy Thursday, both in person and virtual, we had 130 with us. Good Friday was 64. Easter Sunday, 9 a.m., in person and virtual, was 323. Easter in person on 11 a.m. was 202. Easter Sunday, a total of 525 people, and a total for Holy Week of 1,042. And so huge gratitude to our deacons for their service that weekend, to our chancel choir, to our Easter breakfast team, to our communion team, to our communication team, to our Easter egg hunt leaders, and to all of you for your presence with us throughout Holy Week. We are grateful for the gifts that you offer to the ministry and mission of TPC, friends. As our deacons come around with the offering plate, you'll find four ways that you can give online. The easiest being the Give the TPC button in the upper right-hand corner of towsonpress.org. And as we give, may we give with gratitude and joy.
Thank you.
We are here for many different reasons. Whether we are brimming with faith, comfortably resting in a moderate pool of faith, clinging to a tiny speck of faith, or living with no sense of faith at all, we are here. But it doesn't matter why we're here. It doesn't matter how we're here. It only matters that we're here. Because here is a place where we are all welcome. Here is a place where there are no walls dividing us. Here is a place where Christ simply says, take, eat, drink, and remember all of you. So let us gather here at this table, whoever we are and however we are, because Christ welcomes all of us, because we are all guests, because we all need this food. May the God of new life be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the God that we love. Let us pray. Holy God, it was your Spirit in the beginning that hovered over the waters of creation and poured light into the shadows of chaos. You created us in your image, and you call us to live with one another in love, but we so often worshiped the idols of sin and death. You put words into the prophets' mouths so they could speak your words of hope, but we so often refused to listen. Then to keep the promise to never forsake us, you loved us, you sought us out, and you sent Jesus to show us the way. And with parables and simple truths, he opened our ears so we could listen to the words of joy and comfort. As he revealed to us your unconditional love, he opened our eyes so we can glimpse, touch, taste, and live in your kingdom. When he could have ignored our cries for help, he opened his ears and his heart. He shared our joy and sorrow. He brings us words of healing and hope. Remembering all your mighty and merciful acts, O God, you call us to this table of reconciliation. Here in the bread and the cup that are transformed by your Spirit, we are reminded there is no God but you. In this bread, we feast on that grace that can heal a broken world, and in the cup, we taste those promises that we can share with all people. Peace and love, wonder, hope. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these gifts. Make them for us the body and blood of Christ, so we may be for the world the body of Christ. And send us out in the power of the Spirit to live for others as Christ lived for us. And give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day when all the saints of the ages, alongside them, we will feast with you at your table in heaven. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, praise be to you, O God, now and forever. Amen. The night Jesus shared his final meal with his disciples, he took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to each of them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body that I give to you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood and shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink from this cup, do this in memory of me." Friends, when we gather together and we eat this bread and we drink from this cup, we proclaim the saving death of our risen Lord until he comes again. As you come forward, you'll find bread in baskets and juice in small cups, which can be discarded in the baskets to my left and my right. You'll also find you'll find gluten-free communion wafers. The table is set, and all are invited. Our communion servers may come forward. Please join me in our prayer of response that is printed in the bulletin. O God, send us out from our Lord's table to answer his summons into new life and to follow him with joy and gladness. Set our feet in his holy way, that our lives may be signs of his life, and all we do may show forth his love. Amen. Church, as we enter the season of Easter, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed, and the risen Christ is with us this morning, today, and later today, and tomorrow, and the next day, walking beside us. And now may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the power and presence of God's Spirit be with us now and forever. Amen.